Yeah, thank you very much. I need to thank you very much, Piedad, for this wonderful introduction, and also thank you very much for inviting me, for having me here. I had a little bit of a chance to see a bit of the museum. It's unbelievably beautiful. I have to say, I haven't been to San Sebastian before, and it's a real, it's great to be here. So thank you for inviting me. What I will talk about today, and maybe I should, and I mean, Piedad, yeah, and also thank you, Maria Luisa, who also helped a lot for making this true and for that I could come here. So thank you, both of you, and also for the wonderful exhibition. And I will, I'm sure I will be back here tomorrow to see more of this exhibition. We hadn't so much time to see all of it, but it's amazing. So what I want to talk about today is big data war, and maybe just to give you a little bit of a background, it's some time ago, because as I asked Piedad before, why are you interested in the topic of war? I think it's a little bit the same as I'm interested in history. War was always something I was interested in, but in a way I forgot it for some time. And it's more than 10 years ago, I was part of an robotics ethics a project on robotics and ethics. And I think it was even longer, 2005, and I started to do some research on military robots. And the reason why, we did this project together with computer scientists, and they did a little report on what are the contemporary state of art in robotics. And it was like a 120 pages report, but there were only like two or three pages about military robots. And already at that time, when you look at websites that, of, for example, US American robotics laboratories, you always see the DARPA sign. So that's so the funding also comes from the military. And that's when I was started to be interested also in military robots. And I found out already at that time, and at that time, very few people, especially in the Western world, were talking about drones, because I thought that might be something of from a science fiction story. I mean, today, I think most of you know about drones, but in 2005, in Western newspapers, I only find like these little small remarks, there was a drone attack and some insurgents died. That was all. And then I started to read Al Jazeera or Times of India, so newspapers, and I mean, that's some of the advantages of the web, that you can read these new newspapers without running into difficulties. And then I learned a little bit more about it, and that's how I got interested. And what I will talk about today, I think, is one part and about the drones, and another part, which is maybe even more difficult to explain, the role databases and data mining plays. But I will come back to that, and I think these are two very important aspects of high-tech war today. And maybe only as a small background, I think war is highly technologized, at least from the with the beginning of the 20th century. Even the First World War or Second World War, they were kind of industrialized wars. But what I want to talk about today, what is called revolution in military war affairs, or what some people call digital war, high-tech war, I think that's even a step further, and it has a different materiality and partly in a different logic. And I try to sketch some of the, of this. And I hope it will not become too technical, but I want to explain some of these things. So I need my glasses to start. By the way, this is an app which was forbidden by Apple for a long time, the one you see on this side by Josh Bagley, and he did an app where you could see on your phone where a drone attack actually happened, and Apple had a long time an argument that this was too political, or that there was a problem with the app on the smartphone. So I think it took him like 3 or 4 years until he allowed the app, which I found interesting. So what I want to do, first, and maybe this is a very important aspect of high-tech wars. I found a quote by a general. His name is Ronald Fogelman, and he wrote already in 1996, in the first quarter of the 21st century, it will become possible, and that's really interesting, possible to find, fix, or track and target anything that moves on the surface of the Earth. That was his vision in the 1990s. I'm not saying that it's as totally possible today, but I think there are many possibilities now, even really to track people in any possible circumstances, and I will come back to that in terms of that you always also have a fusion of military technology and surveillance and security technology. And this is especially important when it comes to data mining, because data collection, this is not only collection of military data, but also of our data, of everyday data, which becomes part of this idea of tracking and targeting everybody, not everybody, but every possible person on the surface of Earth. To give you an idea, I will talk a little bit, give some introduction on what I mean by this transformed nature of warfare, what some people call revolution in military affairs, and then give you these two examples, talk a little bit about drones and a little bit more about data mining as important aspects of high-tech or digital warfare today. So talking about the transformed nature of warfare, some also talk about the robotic information regime. Maybe what is important for those who are not that much familiar with the recent development of warfare, I think is today mostly we don't have a war where two nations are fighting together. So it's mostly, think of the global war on, so-called global war on terror by the US government. It's often an asymmetric warfare, and it's a warfare against insurgent groups, which are often identified with terrorists or interpreted as terrorist groups. And I wouldn't say that every insurgent can be classified as a terrorist. And I will also come back to definitions of terrorism and what kind of role they are playing in the high-tech warfare. So, and one important part of this transformed nature is, especially the US military is striving for what they call high-tech supremacy via information sovereignty. So it's really the idea that you have a clear vision of the battlefield, for example, that you have a lot of data and that you can kind of control the space you're fighting in, and that you have, for example, drones are also, I mean, as maybe you know, they are producing video images, but they are not only used by drone pilots, but also by groups, by troops on the ground or by the Marines. So it's kind of an exchange of data in all different kinds of directions to give kind of global overview of the battle space. And I think it's at the same time a very high-tech idea of warfare. It's a, and maybe this becomes obvious by when I'm explaining it, it becomes an everywhere war. So it's about access to airspace, to territory in ways which have been unknown before, especially using drone and satellite technologies, and also with the help of data mining. And what is also an important part is, as it is a fight against insurgents or terrorists, as they say, it's a move from traditional warfare towards, you could say, global manhunting. And I think this fits very well to the quote I gave you before, this idea, it will become possible to find, fix, or track and target anything that moves on the surface of the Earth. And if you look at how drones and drone attacks have been used in Afghanistan, or especially in Waziristan, you can see very clearly, and I will come back to that later, that so-called kill lists are produced, where you kind of have, how you can say that in English, a real list of who are the most valued targets, and that you kind of hunt single persons. And I think it's really contested how they make up these lists and how people are get on this list. And you also have terrorist lists. So this is also a very important tool of warfare today. And these lists are produced mostly by information gathering and by data mining. But this is a very important part. So in this respect, it's really manhunting. It's not like two armies fighting against each other, but kind of a huge military apparatus hunting people. I mean, maybe it's obvious, but I think it's just important to state it one more time. So what I said before, just to give you what I said before, what is also important as gathering of information becomes so important, it's also in an increasing entanglement of domestic security surveillance architectures and post-colonial counterinsurgency. So data are not only gathered in military context, but they're also gathered. I will not talk about that much in the end. Maybe we can also have a discussion on that. Recently, we also have something like social media mining. So you're mining Twitter, Facebook, other so-called social media in search for information which might be interesting in the context of the military, but you don't know this in advance. So you're searching the web in a very global way. And there you can, as one example, see this, how surveillance and military technologies and context merge together. I will come back to that later on. So just to give you one more idea of this so-called global information grid, that is the idea that you have a kind of a teleoperated and partly automatized high-tech war. So you have sensors, robots, drones are also robots. What I didn't mention yet, JSOC, so joint special operation teams. And you have this idea of information gathering, of an acceleration of war, and of shared information space, so that everybody can have access to the information which is gathered from as many places as or contexts as possible. What I found interesting, and Piedad mentioned that I also have a background in gender studies, there's a interesting thesis or argument by Christina Masters, who's a English political scientist, or British political scientist, and she said that this, I mean, as I said, we have for a long time, we have a technologization of warfare, but I think this is a really a big step further on in this move of technologization of warfare. And she said the argument that as the U.S. military the military lost the fight in the Vietnam War, that since then they have a real problem with their self-perception, because I think they really felt defeated by troops which were maybe less technically equipped, were less trained, and nevertheless they lost the war. And I think it's interesting also to look at today, because I mean, you know what's happening in Afghanistan, what's happening in Iraq. These wars seem to turn into kind of endless wars. But at the same time, it's a desire for having this informational sovereignty, to keep a distance, to teleoperate, for sure also in the hope to save your own troops. But I think it's also kind of an idea of high-tech masculinity and a kind of a naive belief in the power of technology, which they should have learned in the Vietnam War, that maybe technology is not the only thing how you can win a war. Nevertheless, I think that's one more move towards this direction. So, just to give you a brief, I think most of you have seen these pictures before, just to explain a little bit about these drone systems. They are very important for digital war, they are very important for gathering information, and if you think of how many drones I don't know by heart the correct number of drones, but it's a huge fleet of drones they have today, and they are gathering an enormous amount of information, and this again is data mined, because you can't sit in front of these pictures and have a look on it. You also automatize the search of this material. That's also part of what's happening here. These drones are airplanes with sensors and also often with weapons, but drones are also at the same time used for surveillance as well as for combat. You have a ground control station from which the drones is teleoperated, a communication infrastructure, mostly satellites, and a ground station for landing and starting the drones. The technical aim, and maybe this is not, and I think this is a new phenomenon, the technical or the strategic aim is that you have, how can I explain? You could say a lot of ammunition in airspace at every time available, because drones can stay for quite 1 or 2 days in the air, and then the next drone comes and the other flies away. So you can also, in Waziristan, for example, as part of Pakistan, it's a well-known phenomenon, they are always circling in the air. And that's different if you think of traditional war fighters. I mean, they could stay in air, let's say, for 1 or 2 hours, but now they are always circling in the air. And I think this is also not only talking about strategic aims, but also talking about what does it do to, what are the effects of that kind of warfare? And this is also the question, it's a very old paper, but I really love this is a philosopher of technology, Langton Winner. He asked the question, as we make things work, for example drones, what kind of world are we making? So what are the effects of this new technology? And I come back to that, I would just jump here, below the unblinking eyes of drones. What they are producing is a different, I think, a permanent threat we haven't known before, because, we know from reports, or maybe I should first read the quote, because not everybody starts to read. I will read the quote. Buzzing robots sail through the sky and nobody sleeps. Poor villagers spend their meager savings on pills. At night, they swallow sedatives, and in the morning, they take antidepressants. This is how people live in the tribal areas of Pakistan, far below the unblinking eyes of US predator drones. And this is one of, now more people are talking about that, but in 2010, very few people addressed kind of the consequences of this new high-tech warfare for the people living under the drones, you could say. So this is one of the effects, bazaars are closing, people are no more sending their children to school. They rarely meet because they are afraid. And this has also to do with the classification of who counts as a terrorist, for example, and we have several reports. As a normal family living in Waziristan, if there's some Taliban standing or coming to your house and they ask you for food or for shelter, normally you give them food and shelter. for one reason because of hospitality, and the other reason is you don't want to challenge them. What happens often, the next day, this house is the target of a drone attack, because as they were talking to Taliban, they were also classified as Taliban or as sympathizers of Taliban. So, and this is, I will come back to that when I talk about data mining. So how are people classified? Because what is also happening, and this depends on, oh, sorry, on this idea of warfare, you have less and less people on the ground in Pakistan, for example. You could also talk maybe about Syria, but Pakistan I know more. And the information you gather is mostly signal intelligence, how they call it. So you have video footage, you have knowledge, or you gather who is talking to whom on the phone, these kind of knowledge, but you don't have the people on the ground who really have knowledge about the culture, about the habits, and who are talking to the people. And that, for example, was different in Vietnam War, because being afraid of the battle space, being afraid of losing your own people, you are less and less have an idea what's happening on the ground, and you're more and more gathering data. I think that's what's happening, and this has specific effects. Okay, so as Langton Winner says, as we make things work, what kind of world are we making? What are the effects of these new technologies, maybe also of these new approaches? And what I also like as a feminist theorist of technology, Donna Haraway, she writes, "I believe it is less epistemological, politically, and emotional powerful to see that there are startling hybrids of the human and non-human in technoscience, also, I admit to no small amount of fascination, than to ask for whom and how these hybrids work." So why, give me a second, why I'm talking about hybrids? If you think about who is responsible, and I've been to a conference 3 or 4 years ago, because I would have expected that the military is very excited and very keen on these systems, for example, drone technology. What I learned in this conference, where many people from the military participated, that the politicians actually were much more keen on these systems than the military people. And why? I think one reason for politicians is that they have to justify that people, that the soldiers are dying in the war. And the military was very skeptical, because if you think, for example, of the Geneva Convention, there has always been to be somebody who is responsible for a deed, according to the Geneva Convention. If you think of drones, teleoperated drones, it already becomes a little bit difficult who is really responsible for what's happening in such a huge, again, maybe my picture of this unbelievable battle space. So who is responsible for specific deeds? I think that's getting more and more complicated. It hasn't been easy before, that's not what I'm saying, but it's getting even more complicated, and these drones are more and more automated. I mean, here it says semi-automatized. There are discussions already around, and I think they already achieved autonomous drones. Well, autonomous drones are not acting on their own. There have been engineers, computer scientists, who developed the software. Nevertheless, and that's, I think, that's not the context where Donna Haraway wrote this, but I think she's talking about hybrids, because it's getting more and more difficult to talk about where does the human end and where does the technology begin. So it's kind of, I wrote it with a colleague together, a paper where we were talking about human-machine autonomies, because it's really getting difficult to say who is acting autonomously here. And who is going to take the responsibility? I think this is really a big question in this kind of high-tech warfare. So, the drones I was already talking about, what's happening here, and I don't want to go into that deeply, otherwise I will run out of time, because I also want to address my second example. Not only drones are problematic, but data mining. What you see here, that's the only, and I really don't want to use that term, but that's what it is. It's a kill list, which was leaked by the journalist platform The Intercept. That's, I think, the only kill list we have. And the question is, and that's the problem if you do research in the military field, because, I mean, I can't go do empirical studies, go to the US military and ask him, please tell me, how do you make these lists? But what I was thinking about myself is, what is the, I mean, these lists are databases. It's no more a piece of paper where you have first one is Marie, Luisa, second one is Jutta, and the third one is. It's a database where you bring this information together and where you have tools to data mine. So first of all, you have to have a categorization, who counts as a terrorist or who counts as an insurgent. And then you have to find or to correlate data who gives you an idea who might fit into this picture. And I don't have an exact knowledge, because they wouldn't tell what kind of data mining, so what specific approaches they use or what specific algorithms they use, but I try to get an idea how this might work. So you have this database, and what is also important, which is different to, for example, if you give a report. A report is a kind of a narrative, has a beginning, has an end, and you have kind of some arguments and a causality. In a database, you have just data standing, how do you say for that in English, which is gathered, but has the same status, and which doesn't really give you a story, and which can be mined again and again in different contexts, in different ways. So you have this, and they are based on this information I told you before, which mostly is related to signal intelligence, and have to jump, because what I want to tell you is what makes a terrorist. And I think what I found really amazing is the definition of terrorism, which not really exists, but this is again a leaked document, where they said terrorist activity ranges from hostage taking, assassination or bombing. I mean, these would be the things you would expect, but then they go on with destruction of government property and damaging computers used by financial institutions. They also define as terrorism any act that is dangerous to property and intended to influence government policy through intimidation. Terrorism? And then you begin to think, I mean, on which grounding do they do the categorization for these kill lists, and what is counted, what kind of data is gathered, and how is this searched and categorized? I don't remember the exact number. The kill list I'm talking about, this is the disposition matrix, is a fusion kill list of several lists from the Pentagon, from the CIA, from the JSEC, and they fused this list in 2010. Nobody knows how many people are on this kill list, but what I found interesting, there was a National Terrorism Center which had a terrorist list, and by leaks we learned that 40,000 people were on terrorist lists. Not kill lists, that's a difference. But I mean, imagine, how can it be that thousands of people end up on a terrorist list? And this is due to that you have such a broad categorization of terrorism. And that's how many people end up in this on this list. I gave you one example. For example, they are searching for metadata. Who is talking to whom? Imagine you're living in Waziristan, and maybe you have an uncle who is a Taliban. Bad idea, don't call him. Because, I mean, they gather the data, and you're getting suspicious because you phoned to talk to somebody who is already categorized as a terrorist, which, if you think about it, that needn't mean that you yourself are a terrorist. And this kind of categorization, because, I mean, that's the logic of, that's what you can do with signal intelligence, with data. As I said before, how are people categorized and how do you end up on this list, which is at the same time important if you lead war, as I said before, as manhunting. It's no more like two armies fighting against each other, but you're going for specific persons. So maybe to give you one more example, and that's not from Waziristan, but from a US-American filmmaker. I think maybe some of you might know Laura Poitras. I think she was involved in the leaks of Edward Snowden, and she did also interesting movies on the Iraq War, for example, and she was categorized as a dangerous or suspicious person, I'm not sure about it, but every time she went out or into the US, she was searched. She had to give her computer, her mobile, and so on, because they, on very rough grounds, I could say, or on very loose grounds, they thought that she was involved in a military, not a military, in an attack in Iraq, on the military, on the US military, because they thought she had seen her filming it. But I think there were not really very good reports of that this ever happened. They only knew that in this place she was living and doing this film on the Iraq War. So on very loose grounds, very rough suspicion, you might be categorized as a problematic person. And I think going back to the data mining, so another important thing is not only who are you talking to, maybe who is visiting you, as I said before in Waziristan, also what routes are you traveling, in which countries you're visiting, and this also are criteria for making you a suspect, a terrorist, or even ending up on a kill list. And I brought you one example. Now I'm jumping because I don't want to go into all the data mining. His name is Prop Ahmed Zadan. I think it's a very good example. It's also one of the leaked documents we have. He's a journalist, a Pakistani journalist, and he did interviews with Osama bin Laden. He called Taliban because he did reports on them. He traveled specific routes. I think that's even on this, no, not on this, yes, but you can see routes he traveled. So they have a classification which routes are traveled, which already makes you suspicious. You call the wrong people. And that's how he ended up. And that is what the file is saying. That's from the, I think, the NSA. The highest scoring selector that traveled to Peshawar and Lahore is Prop Ahmed Zadan. And this has also the effect, imagine as a journalist, you figure out it's not a good idea to talk to insurgents. It's not a good idea to travel in war zones because this makes you yourself a suspect. Just to give you an idea of this kind of data mining logic, is, and at the same time, I think it's I mean, this sounds, in the end, okay, you have the traveling, you have the metadata of the phone contacts, but I think the combination is never grounded on causality. It's a correlation. And correlation in data mining says what happened before might happen in the future. This is not, how can I explain this in a good way? In a narrative, as I said before, you give reasons why something is happening. Correlation is based on, good example would be September 11. If you saw the Arabian, if you have a flight license, if you went to university, it might make you a suspicious person, because that was kind of the criteria, or that might be features of the people who did the 9/11 attack. But it doesn't say that this will happen in this way in the future again. But correlation sits on this idea that what happened in the past might happen in the same way in the future, and that's the way how they categorize. Travel the wrong routes, have a flight license, be from Pakistan, maybe also from Saudi Arabia. These are the categories, but it doesn't really give you reasons. And I think this is very, for me, maybe it's also, that's why I was also talking about philosophy of science or epistemology. I think it's an interesting shift that you no more try to really justify and give reasons why somebody might be a terrorist. You just collect features, like you talk to the wrong people, you travel the wrong routes. And I think this is an interesting shift from really trying to explain why somebody might be a suspicious person to just classifying behavior which makes you suspicious. I think I'm running out of time, right? I have only... and I think another problem with this approach is, and I think this is really... you could say lies in the nature of data mining. If you gather data and if you mine data, I think the approach is the more data you have, the more powerful or the more successful the data mining will be. Because, I mean, you have more data and then you can produce more kinds of correlation, you can search for different criteria, and this works always better the more data you have, which ends up in you want to collect as much data as possible. And for example, that this kill list I was talking about, the disposition matrix, was fused out of different kill lists from JSOC, from the CIA, from the Pentagon. This might be also because of political reasons, but I think also because of technical reasons, because it brings together all the information. And just to make this one last step, and I mean, this will be another long talk, and I'm not going into that, but if you look today how much data are gathered also in everyday life, whatever your web page you're searching, we know, you know maybe also that every search you do on the web is gathered, or the data is gathered, whatever you do, and what I said before, the social media mining, because it might be in the future, this data might be relevant because somebody might be a suspicious person. And that's what I said, that this is exactly the phenomenon I was talking in the beginning about, this fusion of civil security and military security, and really this keep adding, also this wish to gather as much data as possible. And this is not only what companies like Facebook or Apple, it's also something which is where politicians, the military are keen on in a civil security context as well as military security context. And I always want to push that just to say, even if it's not that obvious, that in a way also this kind of logic always grows or moves slowly also in our everyday practices. So so that there's a fusion of these aspects. So I will jump to my maybe only this, that's too far, to that one. Here you see, and that's again maybe to state one more time or to make a clear, this is the terror network, so-called terror network of this 9/11 attack. And I think it's, and it's not only me, it's also other scientists or academics who said, after that it happened, it's easy to map this network. But it's very difficult to map such a terror network in advance. Because to do that, you need a very well-defined profile. And that's, again, to say, how do we, if you look at the definition of terrorism, they are very broad because you don't know what will happen in the future. But if you give such a broad definition, if you define it very, define it very loosely, you gather so many people in your net that it's not working anymore. And that's why Bruce Schneier, I think he's very well known as a security expert, he said, data mining for terrorist plots is going to be sloppy and it's going to be hard to find anything useful. But I think that's exactly the wish, for example, of the military and of the security services to data mine these terrorist plots. But I think you get a lot of people who are innocent or maybe, yeah, who are innocent on such a list. So I think it's quite problematic what's happening here. So I come to my conclusion. I think I talk a little bit too much, but it's always happening when I talk in English and not read from my paper. So what I can say, you have this very vague categorization of terrorism. You don't really give reasons why somebody is a terrorist, so you're not building on cause and effect, but on possibility, you could say. And what is also interesting, if you look close on data mining and this idea of correlation, I think it's no more on scientific rigor, which we normally had if you have a technology, but it's more like a trial and error procedure, you could say, because you're combining categories and just have a look what might come out. And even the idea what might have happened or what happened in the past might happen in the future is a very vague assumption, but that's not really a scientific thesis I think you could work on, because I mean I wouldn't know how this this should work. So at the same time, and maybe this is at the same time, I think we also need from a sociological perspective or a political perspective think about why people are believing in this drone technology and this data mining technology. And I think there's also a strong desire to map our very complex and difficult work as close as possible, which at the same time is a very understanding drive, you could say, but I think it's really, yeah, as Bruce Schneier said, a very sloppy way to do it. And in the consequence, I mean, that's my very last thing, I think everybody can become a target, because if you use such broad categories, and if it's no more based on causality, so that you really can give good reason why somebody is a suspicious person, it's going to be sloppy, and that means I think there are different probabilities if some people are categorized as a terrorist, which responds to ethnicity, gender, class, and so on. But at the same time, it's, as I said, a very loose procedure, and I think it's highly problematic what's happening here. And that's how I end, because I could go on and talk about it. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you for your patience. muchas gracias, Yuta, por esta exposición, en cierto sentido, anonadadora, que nos deja anonadados porque vemos que el poder, la guerra, cada vez son más abstractos. Parece que ya no hay responsables, aunque de hecho los haya. Las operaciones se hacen de manera teledirigida, automatizadas. Los drones controlan, los satélites, las cámaras de vigilancia, y parece como que todas las fuerzas de los poderes del mundo están trabajando para desarrollar más y más estas tecnologías del control y de la guerra, que estamos viendo también cómo se están posicionando actualmente en el mundo. Lo que llama la atención es la abstracción cada vez mayor del poder y el anonimato a través de la tecnología, y la importancia de las bases de datos, como por ejemplo lo que pasa en Rusia o las guerras a través de hackers o el control de los datos que puede cambiar las elecciones en un país, son también tipos de guerras, ¿no? Y antes de pasar a la segunda parte de esta sesión con algunas videoproyecciones, quisiera invitarles a hacer alguna pregunta a Yuta. Me parece, perdón, que hay alguien que le van a dar un micrófono. Sí.
El manejo de esa ingente cantidad de datos y de información tiene lugar a distintos niveles, y distintos grandes países tratan de manejarla. Y el control de esa información siempre se procura que esté en última instancia controlado por patriotas. Pero los patriotas también cambian de bando en determinados momentos. Entonces es un riesgo también enorme. Todos sabemos que Osama Bin Laden era el hombre que durante 20 años era el hombre de la CIA y el Pentágono en Afganistán, y organizaba el fundamentalismo islámico desde Indonesia hasta Mauritania. Y bueno, y era un factor of freedom, ¿no? Como decía el New York Times, ¿no? Pero luego esos hombres cambian a veces, los patriotas cambian sus visiones, ¿no? No vamos a entrar al detalle por qué cambió él. Y una persona segura, un miembro de una familia segura, próxima a la familia real saudí, bueno, pueden cambiar. Y de esos cambios, eso ya no llegan a controlarlo, es decir, nos viene luego gente que, bueno, luego se tiene que escapar a otros países, tiene que refugiarse en una embajada, pero bueno, nos pasan millones de datos de esa ingente cantidad de datos. Ese descontrol nos puede generar un caos y un conflicto a nivel mundial, pues como lo vamos a ver y lo estamos viendo, ¿no? Pero es que luego hay otro tema muy importante, y es las víctimas civiles. Todos podemos ser sospechosos, efectivamente. Pero yo no solamente no creo que no les importe que haya más víctimas civiles, sino que para el aparato militar su obsesión, su necesidad vital es que haya guerras. Contra más víctimas indirectas haya, más aseguro está el tinglado militar, se asegura su existencia. No es algo negativo, hombre. Siempre y cuando que no sea algo que llegue a los más media y sea algo muy difícil de. Pero también se soluciona, es decir, todo el mundo sabe que el presidente de Estados Unidos mintió, y lo dijo ante la Comisión del Congreso, el Colin Powell, de que él creó unas bases falsas para justificar la guerra contra San José. Y no ha pasado nada. El mejor hombre del mundo occidental en esa área, que es San José, para una guerra horrorosa, que era la de Khomeini, y es su gran aliado en la zona. Terminan engañándole y se meten en una guerra suicida, invadiendo el país. Es decir, las víctimas no terminan no importando. Lo importante es salvar el tinglado, en mi opinión. ¿Qué opinas sobre que lo importante es salvar el tinglado?
I think it's, first of all, thank you for your comment, but as I mentioned, I mean, it's difficult to do field work, but I think I wouldn't wouldn't blame the military only, but I mean, you also mentioned the politicians, because, for example, I think they are, maybe the politicians are more keen on the teleoperated or on the distance-based technologies because they have to justify, you know, what's happening when people are dying, soldiers are dying. And I'm not sure whether the military always is happy with what's happening here, for example, talking about autonomous drones, because I think they know that they need to justify, and they will be asked on grounds of the Geneva Convention. At the same time, difficult to say, because at the same time, how can I say that? Often I think people became kind of apathic. Maybe that's where you were heading to, because you have the feeling it's very difficult to control data, to control your own data, and even to control, I mean, what narratives are circulated, for example, in social media. I think that's a problem. At the same time, I would say it's not totally new, because, I mean, if you think of, I'm teaching in media studies, and sometimes I talk to my students, and if you see how few people own a lot of newspapers, and as I said, for me it was very obvious when I did the research on drones between 2005 and 2009, because you couldn't find anything in the newspaper, not in Western newspapers, but you could find stories in Times of India and Al Jazeera, and I couldn't quote at that time Al Jazeera, because people would have regarded me as a non-scientific, as maybe even a suspicious person, but you would find these stories there. So I think, I wouldn't say that the world was okay before the invention of data mining and the databases, so I think it's always difficult and it's always contested. So what's happening in the world and who can give, or what are realistic descriptions of what's going on. But I mean, as you said here, that it's getting more complicated, and I think people are getting apathetic because it's hard to find ways to control data, and even what's happening now in the European Union, you can see that data protection gets, at least to German standards, which are very high because of a specific tradition and because of the experience of Second World War, we have high standards of data protection, and they get, how you say, loosened more and more. And if you look what's happening in the European Union, I think that's also a problem, and that's why I was also pointing to the fusion of the civil and the military context. Lots of problems, not easy to solve, I'm sorry.
De todas formas, ¿cuál es su opinión de lo que hemos visto?
The last one or in general?
En general, sobre lo que se ha hablado aquí del control, de la vigilancia, de la guerra a distancia, del poder absoluto que se tiene desde la distancia.
I think collateral murder is really a hard document, but I think remote control is older than digital warfare. I mean, the helicopter is old, in comparison, old technology. I think, and maybe that's the background too, and I haven't done a lot of research on that, but what I found amazing, when you listen to them, they have some ideas about the rules of war. For example, when they say he has to pick up a weapon, at the same time they're always transgressing it, because I mean, people lying on the earth, you're not allowed to shoot anymore. I mean, in,
even in warfare. I mean, if they're wounded and they can't do any damage, you're not allowed to kill them. But I think at the same time, this, I'm afraid, had happened all, not maybe all the time, but I think that's also part of war, and it's not a totally new phenomenon. What is maybe not totally new, but maybe what is also interesting to talk about, who are the victims? And you could roughly say that in the 20th century, I think at the beginning of the very beginning or end of 19th century, it was mostly the military who were the victims in terms of who were dying. So I think it was like 90% the military and 10% the victims were civilians. And I think today it's the other way around. I mean, that's also an important part, that it's mostly civilians who are dying in warfare. And I mean, this is kind of a symbolic representation of how the military, as you said, they are even making jokes about the bastards and so on, and obviously enjoying the killing. So I would say there have always been people who are suffering doing as working as a soldier, and then you always had these, however you want to call them, who obviously are enjoying what they are doing. Because if you look at the first video, I think that's the other, addressing the opposite phenomenon, that obviously people were serving as a soldier and obviously were traumatized. So it's like kind of both end of the scala, you could say. Mm-hmm. So what I also found very interesting was the second. I would be curious how the audience felt about, because so these animations were highly abstract, I think, but at the same time powerful. And actually, I don't know why. Maybe you know, because I'm not an artist. I don't know how you felt, because you could say, okay, this is highly abstract, okay, there are these rubber-like looking persons, and you see the bombs, so what? And at the same time, I found it scary. But actually, do you know why? Or was it the same for you? I don't know why I felt like that. Because normally, if I see like in video games or so, it always feels like, okay, funny, but what's the point? And in this video, it really was, as I said, it was highly abstract, and at the same time, it kind of touched me. So maybe I could ask the audience, how do you feel about it? Maybe it's only me. I would be curious.
Ya es tarde y, bueno, nos gustaría si alguien más tiene alguna pregunta o las impresiones de lo que habéis visto, es interesante también para nosotras. Es una brutalidad, ¿no? Los dos vídeos, por un lado los dibujos de animación, que abstraen de tal manera a las personas. Y por otro, lo que hemos visto en el último vídeo, esa saña de la persecución de un cuerpo que está herido y todavía siguen con el objetivo, ¿no?, hasta destruirlo. Y es realmente fuerte. Sí, por favor.
Sí, hola, buenas noches. Solamente quería preguntarle quizá una cosa muy personal. ¿Hasta qué punto usted puede ser una persona sospechosa? ¿Hasta qué punto usted, como profesora libre de una universidad libre, puede formar parte de una lista negra? ¿O desde otro punto de vista o desde otra manera de preguntarle, usted puede ejercer libremente su profesión o no? Solamente si... No lo sé. Solamente. Muy brevemente. Gracias.
Thank you very much for this question, because hard to answer in terms of yes or no. I think, as I said in my talk, I think there are some people are much more on risk than I will ever be, because I'm a German professor and I know that. On the same time, and I don't feel challenged at the moment, but I found it interesting, I think it's now 5 years ago, I applied for a visa going to the US, and normally you do that online, and immediately, normally, as a German person, you get a reply, and which says, yes, you're allowed to do so. It took 48 hours, and actually what I think what the reason was, I mean, I didn't always use Tor, and I rarely encrypt my communication. So I think there are files, and people know what, I mean, I was searching for Al-Qaeda, and I was searching for drones and so on. So I think somebody had a look on the files personally, because maybe they couldn't automatize and say that's okay. But that's a very small story, and maybe I wouldn't have got a visa, so what? So I would have stayed in Europe. But there's another story of a German sociologist who did work on gentrification. And actually, there was a militant group in Hamburg. I mean, I don't even say if you can call them terrorists, but they, how is it for that? They burned police cars. So they put fire on police cars. They didn't kill anybody. But they were a very radical leftist group, and they wrote a manifesto. And obviously, the police, criminal police, were looking for who might be one of the authors of this manifesto. And the sociologist obviously had used a lot of terms like gentrification, reproduction, so in a way also Marxist terminology. And okay, he has also, he's originally from the GDR, and he has a lot of contact with leftist group, this person. But obviously they had a strong suspicion against him, and for 1 year, his whole family, he's, I don't know where he's married, but he lives in with a woman together, and he has two children, and they were surveyed, monitored for 1 year. There was a surveillance camera in front of the building, and behind the building. And obviously, after a while, they get the idea that he was really one of the authors of this manifesto, and early in the morning, 4 o'clock, they came for him. And they imprisoned him and charged him, made some charges. And I think he was quite lucky, because he knew some other quite famous sociologists, like Saskia Sassen and Noam Chomsky, and they were talking of Guantanamo in Germany. So I think very soon he was released from prison, and in the end, the trial showed that he was innocent. But I found it interesting. I think now they are more careful. This is more like 7-8 years ago. But I mean, on, you know, doing a search on the search engine and to see, use problematic categories again, like you're using the wrong vocabulary. I think another indicator was also he has good historical knowledge. I mean, come on, he's a sociologist, he has good historical knowledge. So very strange categories which made him a suspicious person in Germany. So I think this was one of the few cases where it became obvious, and I think the bigger problem is what's happening in the head of the people. Because, for example, I can see from myself when I'm writing, for example, SMS, I try to avoid specific terms. I mean, don't talk about bombs. Don't talk about terrorism. Don't talk about, and I think this is a very interesting phenomenon, and I think this, as I said, I think I'm more safe like most of the people because I'm a professor, and I mean, I could show them that's my research I'm doing.
Nevertheless, I think there's, I don't know whether this is in English, in German, we say you have a scissor in your head, which cuts out certain things, and then you start not to talk about things, not to do specific things. And I think the other aspect, and it shouldn't become a lamento or something, but actually it's very hard getting funding for this research. With drone it was a little bit different because this was kind of a, became very fashionable. Everybody was talking about drones, and then it got easier that you get funding for research projects. But in general, try to get funding doing research on the military, very difficult. So in terms of there is free research or free science, no. But as I said before, I think there are many people who are much more in danger than I am. But I think as everybody of you, I mean, think of when you act in a way you wouldn't act when you're aware of these things, or people don't bring their mobile. I think there are now recommendations, don't bring your mobile to demonstrations. Because I mean, you have these SIM catchers and then people know you've been part of this demonstration. Think of what's happening if they do social media mining and they know you've been in this place. You start to think about it, and especially in Germany it's very interesting because I mean, we had all these debates on the Stasi, so the security service of the German Democratic Republic. I think what's happening now, in a way, is much more offensive in terms of data collection in Germany and in all over Europe than the Stasi ever did. I don't want to compare the systems, I'm not saying it's the same, but in terms of privacy, and as I said, I mean, people start to change their behavior because they felt challenged. And I think we should think about it because it's a real challenge for democracy.
Bien, en realidad ese es el objetivo del control, el silencio. Pues si queréis ya terminamos esta charla y muchas gracias Yuta por esta exposición que hecho y gracias a todos ustedes también por su atención y por haber acudido y hasta mañana entonces con Sophie Bessis. Buenas noches.